couldn't sleep awake last night. Oh, how I'd love to hold you tight. They say you have a secret life. Well, sacrifice your key to paradise. Take a speaker just like you. I'd ask only we could build a cool.
I couldn't go wrong with anything Brian Ferry's ever done. Or the Roxy, the old Roxy thing. It's just really cute.
It was really an enormous influence on M17's music.
I remember on the inside of the first album cover, it said, hair colour, blue-black.
There are a few bands that can, across a period of decades, always be innovative and always be ahead of the curve. And, yeah, Roxy Music are one of them.
People still name-check them now. People go back and listen to the albums now. So, say they oddly don't sound dated. They are such an amalgam of past, present and future.
Virginia Plain, their first single, wasn't even on their first album, which is quite interesting. When it was played on the radio, when it was on TV, it was just, I think, mind-blowing and made everybody sit up and think, who is this band?
Make me a deal and make it straight. Or sign and seal.
Something I really like about this, he's almost not singing in tune. It sounds at odds with the melody underneath. And that sounds incredibly modern. There's something about that sounds really punky as well before its time.
You're so chic to the rebel of we. Babies up the mountain streamline. Midnight you can see the floors. Dance the cha-cha through to sunrise. Opens up its
tools. I've become slightly entranced by the whole thing of seeing what everyone's wearing. You can see the glitter. Eyeshadow. It's amazing to see rock stars dressed like that. Roxy and Bowie actually both pioneered the glam rock look and the sound. They invented it. It didn't exist before them. And they were real forerunners in a whole movement there.
I remember it so well. I remember especially a friend of mine called Nick Dawson. He would dress completely campy, and we'd go to nightclubs. And he would just wait for that one moment when this came on. And What's Your Name and Virginia Plain.
Because of the age I was as well,
yeah.
You know, I'm like 10, 9, 10.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, and I mean, when I first seen Brian Ferry on Top of the Pops, it was like, we're all watching Top of the Pops, and he looked like me mum.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Brian Ferry. At the time, he had the same haircut and just looked like me mum. But with us, it was again that Roxy Bowie sort of thing.
Yeah. Roxy were amazing.
But the.
They were the future, man.
Yeah.
Getting glam, so glam. Record sounded great.
I mean, it was just one up on glam.
Yeah,
you know what I mean?
Yeah, no, it was. It was like it was beyond glam.
Well, in Ladytron, you get the you really see the beginnings of Eno's genius, don't you?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You can kind of hear a foreshadowing of Here Come the Warm Jets and it's, Music for Airports.
It's very
and all of that
soundscapey,
stuff.
Isn't it?
Definitely.
Beagle on the run around, got me all around town. You've got me, girl, on the run around, and it's getting me down, getting me down.
The early band, almost as if it's a mini war going on between them. There are so many disparate elements and they're all jostling for attention. You've got Andy Mackay on oboe, and how often do you hear an oboe in a rock record, especially a glam rock record? And you've got Brian Eno making the squiggly sounds with the synths, and then the drumming is very solid, very traditional in that way, and somehow it works. I think the tensions in the band, the things that are almost shattering it, but are keeping it together.
I find some in the way of connection, hiding my intention, and then I move up close to you. And I'll confuse you, and then I lose you, but still you won't suspect me.
It's amazing to think that Virginia Plain and Ladytron were of the same moment. They're so different. Of course, there's still the huge inspiration and this glam rock look. Ferry's got a completely different image. His hair's grown, he's a little bit more... I mean, it's much more out there as a song. But what's interesting is the different textures of everyone in the band. I mean, they all have their own little image. I think what makes it so special is like how everybody complements each other.
Listen to all this stuff. It's
come on.
Fantastic. I love the fly glasses. Whoever sourced them.
Such a look.
Stylist award.
Yeah, really.
And of course, Eno, you know. He is solely responsible for me wanting to buy a synth. I actually wasn't bothered about buying a synth to play tunes on. I just wanted one that had a joystick.
Okay.
It looks so cool with the Lurex gloves.
Mm. This is like this amazing mad scientist alien.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Eno was kind of the futuristic bit, really. What Eno's, what is Eno doing? Look, what's that? What's that he's doing there?
Some of the tracks on the Roxy Music album are meant to sound like space landscapes. Brian Ferry would ask Brian Eno, I want you to create something that sounds, you know, like the surface of Mars. They would be very interested in those sorts of concepts of sight, sound, taste and touch all sort of fusing together. And they also say they were surprised that they sold records. They thought that they were going to be really niche, and suddenly the popularity comes and they embrace it.
I think the reason that I loved Roxy Music was the glamness of it all, because Sheffield was, in fact, quite a dour place at the time. The steelworks were on the edge of, you know, working and not working. But the people of Sheffield loved to dress up Friday and Saturday night. And Roxy Music kind of took that to the next level, you know, that kind of dressing up and craziness, which was almost unattainable, but just about attainable enough if you're willing to wear some ladies' clothes, which we were at that time. I remember meeting Martin Ware one day. We were going to see a band at the Student Union in Sheffield, and Martin lived on the flats, slightly dodgy area that you might not like, and I'd gone up to meet him, and he came out of the house and he was wearing white trousers and girls' silver platform boots and a fun fur green jacket, completely luminous, kind of frog Kermit green jacket. And I'm like, whoa, and we're going on the bus like that? And he's like, yep, we're going on the bus. But that's what Roxy Music did to us. You know, it gave us that little push to kind of to push a little further, and that outlet to get to be excited and with fashion and with music.
I do think... Do the Strand. There's a new sensation.
There's a new sensation. A fabulous creation. A danceable solution. To teenage revolution. Do the Strand, love. When you feel love, it's the new way. Do the Strand. Do it on the tables. Quack Eagles Place or Mabel's.
We thought we were so glamorous because we like Roxy Music, and really we were just young kids with no money, drinking watered down beer for 10p a pint, you know. But just for that brief moment of glamour, you know, like pyjama armour and Do the Strand, we would do all the moves and the, you know, throwing shapes and the, you know. We didn't know what any of it meant.
Yeah, well...
But it was like an abstract kind of set of wordscape.
It was this really theatrical... It was this sort of weird anomaly and amalgamation of a whole bunch of different sounds, wasn't it?
They can have a bit of funk when they want to. They're quite danceable, and there's something about the glam punk, but also they can soul up a bit. They can noodle.
In Every Dream, Home and Heartache.
Oh, gosh, yeah.
Yeah, this one is, like, amazing. This is, like, a dystopian sci-fi novel.
Yeah, and a lot darker, isn't it?
It's a lot darker.
And I think that's why they've toned the look down. And he's got a guitar now.
And every step I take takes me further from heaven. Is there a heaven? I'd like to think so. Standards of living, they're rising daily. But home, oh sweet home, it's only a saying. From Belpush to Fawcett, in smart town apartment, the cottage is pretty, the main house a palace, penthouse perfection. But what goes on, what to do there, better pray there.
I love this tune. I love his hair there as well.
I know, it's very kind of 60s or 50s greaser.
Yeah. And that jacket.
Oh, it's so great.
So this is off the second album, For Your Pleasure. And apparently this song is a love story to a blow-up doll, but also about the emptiness of modern life.
I bought you mail order, my plain rapper baby. Your skin is like vinyl, the perfect companion. You float in my new pool, deluxe and delightful, inflatable doll. My role is to serve you, disposable darling. Can't throw you away now, immortal and life-size. My breath is inside you, I'll dress you up daily and keep you till death size. Inflatable doll, lover ungrateful, I blew up your body, but you blew my mind.
That you could do Virginia Plain, and you could do stuff like this, which was very different, very different to what anybody else was doing.
A lot of characters in Roxy Music. There was obviously going to come to a point, which was a shame it came so soon after the second album, that there was just too many personalities, and Brian Eno left the band. I think the two Brians going their separate ways because of their clashes of their personality was quite difficult for a lot of the other band members. I think they were really split with their loyalty. Phil Manzanera secretly had to record both albums. He was recording Stranded in the day and Brian Eno's album at night, and they both didn't know.
So there are official reports why Brian Eno left the band, and there seems to be everybody's got a different angle, is what I've heard. Apparently they're still friends, though, now, the Bryans, and they do sometimes collaborate.
So on the third album, which was the first album without Brian Eno, there was a fantastic track called Street Life. Wish everybody would leave me alone, yeah. They're always calling on my telephone. When I pick it up, there's no one there. So I walk outside just to take me in. Come on with me, cruising down the street. Who knows what you'd see? This album, without Brian Eno, went to number one in the UK charts, and Street Life gave them their first top five hit as well. Seems to me that Brian Ferry just wanted to stand out, and if he couldn't stand out wearing sequins anymore, he had to do the opposite. And it's quite ironic that he, you know, he stood out by just putting on a suit. And he's a young man, and young men didn't really wear suits then, especially white suits with a bow tie. But again, it's simple but very glamorous and very sexy. So it's creating a whole new image.
To Roxy is that they went slightly out of the glam thing and into this classic rock. Some of the songs are quite traditional in that sense. When we get the third album and then onwards, people seem to be contributing a little bit more. But they were stronger without Brian Eno at that point. I think they would have exploded if Eno had decided to stay in the band.
So after the third album, when they were at the height of their success, Brian Ferry decided to make a solo album, which was a series of covers.
One of the first singles I just ever went out and bought on me Jaxxies was, you know, a Brian Ferry Hard Rain.
Oh, where have you been, my blue-eyed son? Where have you been, my darling young one? I've stumbled on the side of 12 misty mountains. I've walked and I've crawled on six crooked highways. I've stepped in the middle of seven sad forests. Love.
I mean, what it feels like, it's just great, really, when you're kind of, when you've got such a defined sound as a band, that you can cover something in your style. I think it's really cool, because I think it ultimately shows a lot of respect that you don't try and, you know, match any of the instrumentation or the sort of, or the stylistic approach. You just do your thing, but honor an amazing song. So, yeah, this is such a great version.
The solo albums kept coming, and Brian Ferry kept going back to these covers, and he would cover songs by artists that were his heroes.
They asked me how I knew my true love was true. I of course replied, something here inside cannot be denied. Oh. They said someday you'll find all who love are blind. When your heart's on fire, you must realize smoke gets in your eyes.
This is tongue-in-cheek, I'm assuming. There's it's quite like kind of arch and knowing, I feel, sending up that type of lounge cabaret, slightly cheesy music, kind of Copacabana vibes.
Yet today, my love has flown away. I am without my either.
It was harking back to 50s crooners. It was harking back to 40s film stars. Brian Ferry, in his heart, is Humphrey Bogart, I think. That's what he had studied at art school, and that's what he wanted to go with. He wanted that crooner idol thing.
Now laughing friends deride, tears I cannot hide. Smile and say, when a lovely flame dies, smoke gets in your eyes.
My entry point to Roxy Music was the big record collection that my uncle left in our basement when I was like 10 years old, as he went off travelling. And yeah, so I think I found Siren in there somewhere, flicking through them, and that was the first one I heard.
Love is the drug. Just look. That's the essence of cool right there. There's a club called the Crazy Daisy in Sheffield, and they would play an interesting mix of music. But this was the anthem. This was, and it was a really weird club. It had a kind of a low roof, And because I'm quite tall, I can only dance in one place on the dance floor, because if I moved to the left or right, I would cut my head. And in fact, that's where Phil Oakey met the two girls from the Human League. And they were dancing exactly like that. They were the kind of Roxy girls. Ain't no big thing to wear for the bedroom. Ain't no big thing the toll of the bell. Aggravated, spare for days. I troll downtown, the red light plays. Jump on, bubble up, what's in store? Love is the drug and I need to score. Showing up, showing up, hit them run. Boy meets girl where the beat goes on. Stitched up tight, can't shake free. Love is the drug, got a hook on me.
This is a song that apparently everything was recorded apart from the vocals, so the band didn't even know what it was about until Brian Ferry came in with his lyrics and sang over the top. And I think increasingly he would sing over the top of a backing track, which is interesting in that they weren't jamming or doing anything. They weren't fusing it, it was quite separate. And this again is one that, a song that doesn't have a standout chorus, it's part of the verse.
Lumber up, limbo down.
Why did he wear that patch? I mean, there was one rumour that he was hit by a tennis ball, but it's quite funny. I mean, he's done quite a kind of unslick patch, because you've got the patch and then you've got a bit of cotton wool hanging out, which is not as glamorous, but then I guess he's got the safari suit and the moustache to go with it, so it makes up for it.
This is Let's Stick Together, and I can't believe Brian's really playing that mouth organ.
Again, it's sometimes difficult to tell a Brian Ferry solo from Roxy Music because they have a very similar musical aesthetic from that 76 period onwards.
And now the marriage vow is very sacred. The man's put us together now. You ought to make it stick together. Come on, come on, and stick together. You know we made a vow to be one another forever. But now you know.
This actually is a cover of a 1962 soul classic. But what I like about this song, and I like about a lot of Brian Ferry songs, is the fact that the lyrics are so honest. You feel his pain. He's really good at, like, conveying emotion. You made a vow not to leave one another. I mean, could we not all say that too? You know, you made a vow. Stick to it. Let's stick together.
There she is. There's Jerry Hall. That's unbelievable, isn't it? How cool is this video? Yeah, I mean, he's always had a quite attractive females around him as well, hasn't he, Brian? Which is not surprising because he's a very good-looking guy. Not sure about the moustache there, Brian, but it's almost working. And also, if I'm to be brutally honest, his dancing always left a little something to be desired. But other than that, he styles it out very well indeed.
Brian Ferry loved his covers, but also he liked to be inspired by different things. And this song is original music of his, and it was inspired by his former art teacher. It's a kind of a little bit Miami Vice or something, the shades and a little bit... it's very laid back, isn't it? It's just very, he's just always cool.
I'm not sure why Brian Ferry goes off and the band go, and he does the solo career. Maybe that he just felt that he needed to strike out and be 100% Brian Ferry rather than 95% Brian Ferry and a bit of Roxy music in the background. But again, it's his vision. You can see how fastidious he was. The cover art is very important with Roxy music, and he continues that theme. And you can very easily mistake a Brian Ferry later record for a Roxy music record. They're not musically that different when we get to that late 70s.
Glasgow like the commercial Roxy music because the Roxy music we're talking about in the beginning was like, you know, was really out there, like in Every Dream Home, Heartache, you know, and stuff like that, and like Ladytron, that was out weird, out there records. But by the time they got to Dance Away,
yeah,
the whole of Glasgow, like, yeah, probably the whole of Manchester liked Roxy music.
Yesterday, well, it seemed so cool when I walked you home, kissed goodnight. I said it's love, you said alright. It's funny how I could never cry until tonight, and you passed by.
I mean, this song is definitely slicker and more sophisticated.
He had such a sort of way about him, just the way that he carried himself, the sort of the voice, even the slightly kind of over-affected performance. Turn to stone, all together, all alone, all at once, my whole world.
Close.
must walk the line until I find an open door off the street onto the floor. There was I, many times a fool. I hope and pray, but not too much. Out of reach is out of touch. All the way.
There isn't one member, apart from Phil Manzanera, of Roxy Music that wasn't brought up in a working-class household. So something about this playing with the idea of aspiration and elevation and another world is very close to them, and they lived it. And, you know, they did go on and marry supermodels and have incredibly posh children, so they did it in some form. They really understood that, and it's what Bowie understood and what pop music can do. Sounding slicker, late 70s, 80s, is a progression of just the form is getting more and more polished like a pebble and becomes something that without edge, which is, happens to most bands, really. It's very hard to get that edge back. Maybe it's that natural inclination to smooth everything over, production values go bing.
Be really tender, you know. I love the way he was really kind of tender with his vocal as well as kind of theatrical and slightly, you know, absurd and surreal at times.
Interesting how you see, like, some bands kind of start off really subtle and break their look and get more and more crazy, and he's kind of gone the other way. It's so easy to become a cliche of yourself when everyone else is emulating you. Songwriting was, you know, his ultimate talent, and his ballads and the way he could hook you in.
It's sometimes since we said goodbye. Driving alone to a movie show.
It always is inspiring when you kind of when you're a big fan of an artist or a band and you realize where they've come from or what they've gone through or the changes that have happened around them. And I think it's just, yeah, I think it just shows, for me, it shows freedom of expression and just, you know, it goes back to that art school kind of beginning where you're not closed off to anything.
Now the party's over, I'm so tired. And I see you coming out of nowhere. Much communication in emotion. Without conversation or a notion.
Brilliant, fantastic tune, so effortlessly cool. And no matter what happens with the band with Roxy, because the members seem to change almost weekly, you know, they were in, they were out, but the music always hit the same level, didn't ever falter.
And of course, there's that kind of iconic vocal at the end, which, as far as I'm aware, happened quite by happenstance when Brian Ferry was in a recording studio in New York and heard this kind of celestial voice from the next booth or from a booth that was close by, and went in to investigate and found, I think, a pretty, I don't know that she was very well known, Haitian singer, and just asked her if she would do a guest vocal on the track. It was recorded in one take. And then it made it on to this huge hit. To me, it seems like it was all conquering. I feel like when I was very little, it was everywhere. And yet to me, this is this is Roxy music. This is like my association and memory of them.
I could feel at the time there was no way knowing falling leaves in the night. Who can say where they're growing as free as the wind? Hopefully learning why the sea.
Seems less ironic to me than some of the earlier kind of playing with that kind of, I guess, kind of cabaret type singer look. This actually seems kind of more genuine, like this is what they are. Enormously influential, and I don't think that will stop. There is something about that concoction, and I think they are a concoction and a confection that people really adhere to, and musically they're so interesting that musicians will be listening to them in 10 years' time.
Roxy Music will have an everlasting legacy for me. I think, yes, they had style, but more importantly, they had substance, and I think they will live on forever and ever.
They know the in crowd is out of sight.